Anyway, lots of pieces. All right, so all of that will be left up. I will talk a little bit more about one more piece. So this is just going to be a little short thing on complexification. This is obviously an incredibly vast piece that could go on forever and will take a long time to sort out. So for instance, you know, the origins of life, like the beginning of life, that's a difficult, very difficult problem, right? And people have been thinking about it for a long time. We've gotten somewhere with it, but you know, you've got a big soup of chemicals, like how does that turn into life? So I think what I'll show you is we can stitch some pieces together. You know, for example, the Big Bang seems to be this thing we're pretty happy about, right? But, you know, like there's the start of all of that, which is weird. Like that's a little upsetting. But once it gets going, we're like, oh, you know, here we have all this history of stuff. So we can kind of understand that. But let me just talk about a few things. So there's this general tension between two pieces. The tendency towards, and we've sort of seen some of this, what we'll call universality coming out of physics, that certain shapes and patterns and behaviors will emerge from microscopic interactions repeatedly, right? We'll see certain patterns over and over again. And so that's this story here, right? So that the details don't exactly matter. We'll get these kind of overall macroscopic emergent behaviors repeatedly. In terms of the physics world here, Leo Kadnoff is very famous, passed away a couple of years ago. But he had this great realization about renormalization was his work. Anyway, this is a spectacular thing, right? So just a very basic math thing. If you add a whole bunch of random variables together, as long as they don't have anything exploding in them, then this beast pops out, right? And you know, that's remarkable. And it was the discovery of this was, you know, sort of a great moment for people thinking about the world. As I've said, this is the statistics of snoredom, of boringness, and the statistics of surprise. Power law size distributions are, you know, something we need to worry about. But let me talk a little bit about fluids, which, you know, sort of may seem outside of the scope of this, but fluids is sort of our great achievement in understanding complexity, right? We have micro interactions leading to macro behaviors, and there isn't a tornado sitting inside a water molecule, so we've been able to figure out some pretty spectacular things there. Phase transitions and static. So the details don't matter too much, right? So that's not always true. Of course, sometimes it does, and this is the distinction I'm going to try to build just in this last piece. Universality means that fate does exist for certain things, right? So if we run the universe again, what are we going to get? Well, we will get suns and stars, right? Stars and planets. That's something we understand, and I'll come back to that in a second. Right, what's a possible long-term situation for us? So fluid mechanics, as I said, it's the great success of complex systems, perhaps the initial success, because it turns out we just needed pencil and paper to figure that out, right? That we didn't need to simulate things. When it comes to people and everything involving us, we kind of need to have much more, there's more algorithmic behavior. Same with biology. So experiment theory simulations, they've been able to do this over and over again. I showed you the ridiculous cat lapping situation, right? Cat lapping milk, for example. But this is kind of astonishing, right? So, you know, blood, oceans, atmosphere, how the Earth behaves internally. Navier-Stokes equations. I mean, that's really extraordinary, right? And I think a priori, it's not obvious at all, right? First of all, that we, you know, if you go back in time far enough that we'd be able to write down mathematical equations that govern this at all, and that the equations, once you've got past that and you've discovered calculus and all these sorts of things, the idea that the equation for, you know, maybe honey and milk are the same. It's just different parameters, right? Viscosity is different. That's not obvious. And it means you can go out and do some pretty peculiar things. You can actually build a different microscopic picture, one that doesn't exist in the real world, but is nice for computers. So this is a hexagonal lattice. I'm going to talk about universality with hexagons. Hexagonal lattice. So imagine you've got particles running around on this lattice, and if they hit each other like this, then you make them kind of go off in those directions. If you have three hitting each other, they do this. So these are little microscopic collision rules for ball bearings, just smashing around on a lattice, right? They can't, they hit each other. It's not a diffusion thing. They're going to hit each other. All right, so you start with that. You do a lot of math, and you end up with the Navier-Stokes equations for 2D, which is kind of extraordinary, right? So this means you can simulate things very spectacularly. People do this. This has been going on for 20, 30 years. But universality is so strong that we can actually make up a different micro picture that is good for us, good for our computers. They're happy to eat it. That will give rise to behaviors that we're interested in modeling. This is for 2D. Turns out the hexagonal lattice is the only one that works in 2D. And it's because regular lattice, because if you take a hexagonal lattice and squish it and strain it and do these sorts of things, it feels like a solid. You can't feel the lattice in it, right? This is a very special property of it. If you have a square lattice, you can do this sort of thing and you'll go, oh, you know, it kind of has some shear that's weird this way, but it's different to this way. You'll be able to feel that internal structure. So in 3D, there's no such lattice. So the insanity is you go up to 4D, where there is such a lattice, and then project down. That's not great. anyway, so you can make, right, so this is a game. Sometimes we want to make a micro interacting story that will produce a completely new system, you know, whatever it is, a social system or a way of building a smart grid, whatever it is. You know, we want to make up things with different micro rules that will lead to a healthy system that will do interesting things. Sometimes we want to recreate a real system with a fake underlying one. Anyway, I want to say more about hexagons. They appear all over the place, right? So this is another good universality and sort of a different things. there's a famous book on growth and form, which was it's been very popular for a long time, I think more with physicists, but this guy was an incredible polymath, and it's just lots of thinking about optimization in biology, beautiful drawings and things. Anyway, so hexagons do appear lots of places, Giant's Causeway, and I think in Hellboy 2 as a result. This is from cooling, right? You see cracks and things form into these pieces, quite beautiful. Saturn has a very big hexagon. That's a large hexagon just sitting on the end of it, which is, I think, maybe more recently people have been able to explain this a little bit, but there's just a giant storm situation. But this is, the Earth would fit in here. So it's a big hexagon. Lots of hexagons appear. Graphene, we're very excited about that. Lots of money has gone into this. This is the Blues Brothers, which, yeah. Okay, good. Thank you, God. one of the great car chasers of all time. Okay, so this is just, I won't show you all of this. This is rather remarkable. This is from the Global Hexagonal Awareness Resource Center, which is a remarkable tribute to hexagons. All I'm saying is that these things appear over and over. There's a universal structure to these guys. Look at the 20 seconds. So this goes on for a long time. I think Saturn will appear at some point too. Like, it just really gets excited. Let's see one. Oh my God. Sorry, it's somewhat transfixing. I know I should stop this. I can't help myself. I just want to see one. He regrets this. Come on, show me one other fun thing. Anyway, all right. See, it's just like really, really falling apart. Turtles. Well, they got hexagons, right? Here we go. That makes no sense. That made no sense. That makes no sense. Okay. Wow. That was sad, I think. That's good. That's just, anyway. All right, so this guy's excited about it. And it's does it still exist? Yeah, look, a whole thing. It hasn't been updated for a while. Just huge. Anyway, they're real things. Of course, you know, 6-fold symmetry, you also get a nice variation on this, right? Which was, we always get this for snowflakes, but they're all different. So there's a path, that's a sort of a nice emblem of path dependence connected to hexagons. Famous piece in all of this thinking about complexity business is symmetry breaking from Anderson, who's a, you know, I think at some point was assessed as sort of the most creative scientist ever, and it was based on how many citations he would make of other people's work based versus the citations of his work, right? I mean, I don't think he was bad, you know, like Einstein. I mean, there wasn't as much stuff around, but Einstein would have a paper with like one citation or none, which is true early on. Yeah, there it is. Anyway, so this was a real call to arms at the point, because the way it was framed was only particle physicists were doing real science, and everyone else was just doing some sort of applied stuff. And that's not really true, right? So if we do understand, if we have all the micro, it doesn't really matter about gluons and all these sorts of things in terms of what happens with society, right? And the story is, you know, only certain things manifest at higher scales. You get symmetry breaking, you get certain kinds of, once life takes off, you get certain kinds of organisms, you have the whole game of evolution and so on, but you don't get every possible thing that could have been achieved. And there are just simply laws and rules that can't be derived from some sort of fundamental theory of everything. And so this is his framing, right? So the laws of the, so X obeys the laws of Y, right? So psychology gives rise to social sciences. This is just what how he's framed. Psychology comes from physiology, chemistry, right? So there's this hierarchy going up. And it's not that, if you just understand this one, you map them all down, right? That doesn't work at all. They're all different kinds of games. So this, the version of this was to, the achievement here was to sort of move people's brains out a little bit and say, oh, everyone is doing really important stuff. Right, so the more we understand about fundamental laws, the less relevance they seem to have to the very real problems of the rest of science. And so it's scale and complexity mean that you can't just build out from knowing about quarks, which is disappointing. You're not going to predict a platypus, for example. So, and, right? No one predicts a platypus. So path dependence is going to matter at some point. So, the two big pieces are, you have universality, yes, you know, that's going to force certain shapes to appear and kinds of systems to appear, but there's path dependence as well. This is an older book by Didier Sonnet, which he sort of claims renormalization basically gives you everything, but it's not as simple, that's not true. Okay, this is XKCD, right? So this is the XKCD version of Anderson's hierarchy, right? So everyone, so it adds the extra piece that people obnoxiously look down on the one below them, so the physicists are here, of course, and then, this is a joke, and then the mathematicians are weirdly off by themselves. Citation patterns work like that too, right? So this is all connected, but the mathematicians tend to get a little further away. I don't know, the trousers bifurcating realities, right? So that's, so it's not about every, just the small thing, it's the increase of complexity, and it's this interplay between universality and symmetry breaking. So there are certain things I think we're going to be able to predict, right? So, but, right, so that is a bit of a problem. Entropy is going up. But we do see complexification. So why is that? And the story, I'm just going to jump that one, I think. This is a one-page piece by Brian Arthur, who's a famous Santa Fe Institute character. Why complexify, right? So he has an argument based around performance, brings a ratcheting cycle. He's going to be talking more about, I think, in terms of evolution and social phenomena. But as soon as life takes off, the advent of life, then you have potential for games, right? And evolution is games and competition and so on. And that becomes an arms race. And so you get complexification, which is very different to, you know, thinking about how planets form, right? So this is a very different thing. This is a game of algorithms once life takes off. So this is what I'm going to kind of claim here, that once we're lifting and lifting and lifting away from physics into algorithmic worlds. right? So life is a kind of a loaded thing. Do we find algorithms out there? So history of everything, right? So Big Bang, there's going to be like just a big mess. Eventually, and I'll have a little bit more to say about what happens here in the next slides. Once you get to life, then you have biological evolution, and then these kinds of evolution all take off. And as I said, these are all games, and algorithms become a big part of everything, and that allows you to lift away from physics, which is always there. It's always going to be an issue. This is, you can actually, well, I guess if you click on the link, you can get a copy of it. You'd have to log into this thing. This is a review of Jeff West's book on scale, and we talked about scaling at the start of the course. And I alluded to some of this stuff in biology that was problematic. Anyway, so this book is not good. But Freeman Dyson, very famous physicist and famous smart person. So he points in the middle of this to this book. I think that's a misspelling with that thing. I'll fix that up. It's Fang Zhi. And his wife, Li Xuan. So they have this book called the Creation of the Universe. Very interesting thing to read through. And they have this point in there that right, lots of writing here. Here's really the picture I want you to see, given time. So gravity is the big cause of complexification, essentially. So this is a really profound piece, right? So gravity exists. We'll take that as read. So without gravitation, right, if you just have stuff floating around in a big soup, then it's just going to become, there's actual structure here, then it would just sort of randomly fluctuate and end up being a big soup. But if you start with this and gravity is in play, then any sort of heterogeneity, like there's just some, like, there's just randomness, there's going to be some sort of concentration that's a little bit higher in some places, you'll start to get collapses and you'll start to then form galaxies and of stars. And so that's a profound profound point. If you read through, this is just the last two pages of one chapter, this is a really profound observation. So this is going to, even though we're going to form suns that are very hot, entropy is going to increase, structure is actually also going to increase at the same time, right? So this fights against this kind of terrifying result, the second law of thermodynamics, that entropy is always increasing or staying the same. So that things are going to fall apart. But because of gravity, because it's this large scale thing, you're going to get structures, and they're going to be nice structures, right? They're little balls floating around, big hot balls. And then we have that next layer of, well, life taking off and so on. So that's been thought about quite a bit. I don't know where what point we'll get to something that's really definitively agreed upon there. But then once life takes off, which to me is the advent of algorithms, then you have a ratcheting through evolution in terms of complexification. So big transitions, big bang, big randomness, then you get big structure, which is planets and so on. So once you get some simple sort of chemical things like replications and so on, and then you start to get to a more complicated piece with life, loops, and these are algorithmic pieces in themselves. Certainly physics and chemistry all involved deeply, but you've got a kind of game being played on top of it. Eventually you get out into, I'm going to say these things, now we're at human levels, big word, big story, big number, big farm, that's agriculture, belief systems spreading across the whole world, big make, big city, right? So these things are, spreading, becoming planet-wide. Science, right? We're only a couple of hundred years into actually knowing anything it's taken a while. And as I said at the start of the course, 100 years really since we, just over 100 years since we agreed that atoms exist. And you wouldn't get thrown out of a physics conference for saying they did. Information algorithms, big connect, big social, big awareness, I don't know, big something. So there's some ordering of things. But you could have big bang, it goes poof, like it doesn't work out, right? But once you get this big structure piece, what's the probability of life taking off? This is a much debate, as I said, much debated, much kind of worried about sort of thing. Is there life out there? Question. What was it? What's his name? I've forgotten his name. 400 years ago, 1600 in Italy. Why don't I remember his name? Burn at the stake for saying that all those stars out there are suns as well. Yes.
Bruno.
Yes, Bruno, yes. I have a, stood in front of his statue and took a picture. I'm sorry, it skipped my mind. But it took a, so he, there's a statue that was erected in maybe 1900, and he faces the Vatican. It's in a, he's just standing there with the books. And of course has things of him being burnt to death on the side and talking about what happened. But yeah, he just said, yeah, I think there will be beings living on these other, there'll be planets, and they said no. So this is an old kind of thing, right? So there's some theory of anything, right? So we're going to have to sort this out at some point. But emergence is really the big story for systems. We have places where the so-called hard sciences, so you know, fluid mechanics is in here, where we've been able to get these micro macro things to work. Typically differential equation, PDE kind of stories there. And then as we get out to the soft and squishy sciences, it's harder to measure. Of course, that's changing a lot in the last 20 years. But this is a sort of a slow progression. But I do think there's a difference between here and here, right? That these were things that could be solved with equations, like continuum kind of things, and then you're out into algorithmic stuff. All right. So that's going to be the end. I find it useful to say this. How to do science. So find interesting, important things to work on. That's hard, right? That's a question of taste, actually. So taste is a really big thing. And I want that to be, right? So taste matters. There's an unbelievable, you know, sort of abundance of things to work on. And you can really go down rabbit holes, and that's okay. You know, sometimes those rabbit holes are very helpful for other rabbit holes you need to explore. You know, and this is really, this is going to seem almost childish, but it is the sort of stuff you see in maybe grade four. Describe what you see and explain. And I think that's a really important thing to just keep coming back to with science. It's describe and explain, right? Choose the right thing to work on. That's hard. And then describe and explain. So that's really basic science. But then you get to these other pieces where it's create, predict, control. A lot of people want to go straight to this, right? And we're in a very tricky age with dark magic or deep learning, you know, for example, where we can go past this part and go straight to prediction, which is really, you know, great and powerful and so on. But we've had this in the course early on, the fundamentals part. You know, maybe we'll be able to predict but not explain. I mean, it would be good to get to a point where we say we can predict it but we can't explain it and we know why. That would be an achievement. So that's okay too. It is what it is, right? And then share, of course, right? Spread things out. I do want to say, you know, I've kind of focused on certain things in this course, and you'll see that in every course. But, you know, you don't need to go out there and say everything is a network and everything is a power law, such, you know, whatever the things that I've talked about too much, I suppose. But, you know, I do think that's important. You need to, there is an enormous amount of science where you just sort of, people are, you know, it's reasonable to try it out, porting tool sets over. You should try it, but don't be too upset if it doesn't work out. Okay, so good. I'll just mention that we do, I have the follow-up course. It's called Complex Networks, or Coconuts, actually. There's no reason for that. well, it was sort of complex networks, but it was just a real stretch, yeah. I used to call it Conks, which was a English game. Anyway, so this is next semester, but it's going to be a smaller thing. You know, this is a typical material in here, and you've seen some of it already because I ported that piece into this course. Generally focused on networks, but it's actually become more of a hybrid. So I have that's kind of feeds into what I would like to call storyology. So some of this stuff I talked about even just today, right? Happiness, measuring sentiment, all the text kind of behavior and so on. So that, in the last version of it, half of the course was about this. But the idea would be to make it more of a, the whole thing be more developmental again, because I think it's a rebuilding time. And, you know, get some of the projects that you guys have been working on to fruition. So if you're interested in being around, we'll do that. It's going to be at 1, I can never remember the times that these things start, but the 1 p.m. slot, Tuesday, Thursday, 1:15. And it will be over actually in Farrell Hall in the Decision Theater, where decisions are made. near the think space. There's a think space and a decision theater. Anyway, the indecision theater is what I call it. Okay, so that's it. Thank you. It's been great. And we'll be back on Tuesday so you guys can talk about things, right? 7:30. Oh my God, but it is 7:30, and show up and bring breakfast, I suppose, and coffee and things like that. It's been a pleasure. Thank you so much, and we'll see you soon. All right, okay.